evening. It's good to see each and every one of you here to continue on with our studies and understanding where we are in time. And we just praise the Lord for the opportunity to be here with you, to share with you once again what we believe is events taking place to help us to know where we are in time. We believe probation's fast closing. Jesus is coming soon, and we, by God's grace, want to have a people prepared. You know, I was going through a very difficult time many years ago, and I'd given my heart to the Lord, and of course, the enemy of souls came out with full force to try to destroy and tear down my family and everything involved, and I had the opportunity for the first time to give my first sermon, and it was a very shaky situation, and still is today most of the time. But the Lord realized that I'm learning, I'm growing. He had some more things He wanted to teach me. But I was praying and pleading with God that if I ever had an opportunity to preach to His people, or share to His people again, what types of messages do You want me to share? What do You want me to share with Your people for this time that we're living? And I went home, and as I was praying about this, I was impressed to pick up a book called Early Writings. It was laying on my bedside stand. And I picked that up, and it opened up to page 119. And this is the first thing that caught my eye. The angel cried, "Get ready, get ready, get ready, for the fierce anger of the Lord is soon to come, and ye are not ready. Rend your hearts and not your garments. A great work must be done for the remnant." So not only is there a great work that must be done for the world, but there is a great work that must be done for God's remnant people here in the times in which we live. And so this is what Project Restore is all about. And that is to restore the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the children to the fathers before the great and terrible day of the Lord. And so tonight we're going to be sharing some things with you, the reason why we believe that the great controversy is fact, it is not fiction, and that the signs are telling us that everything is about to wrap up. And so we hope to convey that by God's grace and through His Spirit here tonight. Before we begin and look at Scripture, if you would bow your heads with me, and let's seek the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank You once again for the privilege, for the opportunity of being here to worship and to fellowship and to share Your truths for such a time as this. And so we invite Thy Holy Spirit's presence to be with us. We invite Thy holy angels to walk to and fro among us. We pray that You'd rebuke the devourer, and Lord, send Your Spirit to touch my mind, my heart, my thoughts, my actions. May everything I say and do here this evening be in accordance with Your will, in accordance with Your plan, for Your glory and for Your honor. We pray these things and we thank You. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles with you, and I hope you do, if you would open them to Hosea chapter 4. I'm going to look at a verse in Hosea chapter 4 for a moment, and we'll give you just a second to look those up. We have some very clear admonition from the Lord and some understanding here that we can learn from that God is trying to reveal to His people, I believe, here at the end of time. Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6. The Bible says, "My people," who? My people. God says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee." The Word of God says, "My people will be destroyed for lack of knowledge." In other words, a lot of people say, well, what we don't know won't hurt us. You ever heard anyone say that? Oh, yes. A lot of people say that. As a matter of fact, my father had a spot on his lung back in 1971, and he didn't know it. He started developing a cough. And after a while losing some weight, he decided he better go to the doctors. He went to the doctors. He had some testing done. They found a spot in his middle lobe of the right lung, and he didn't know it. We buried him in August of 1971. So what you don't know will hurt you. We need to know for these things. God says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge." And so we are attempting to do here tonight, and what we've been attempting to do through this short series is to help God's people realize where we are so that we can be prepared for His soon coming. Well, one of the reasons why we're having such a difficult time as well, especially in Adventism, of course, and that is the Bible tells us my people not only are destroyed for lack of knowledge, but it also says where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no vision, the people perish. And what I'm finding, and it shouldn't be amazing to us because we're told this would happen, is that there are a lot of people who do not put much trust or much faith in the spirit of prophecy. So I'm here to ask you tonight, Ellen White and the writings of Ellen White and the spirit of prophecy, she is either of God and a messenger of God, or she's a liar. She cannot be both. She has to be one or the other. And I believe that God has used this person to help us in these end times to know exactly where we are and what we should be doing here at the end of time. So I want us to take a look tonight as we look at the great controversy, Fact or Fiction. This book, written in the 1880s, was written in telling us of things not only of the history of the church, but also the events to take place before Jesus comes. And I want us to take a look at those things tonight. And let's see whether this person had some insight from the Spirit of God or not. Let's take a look. Paul, in the book of Romans, Romans chapter 13, verse 11 and 12, we read this. And that knowing the time, it is high time to do what? It's high time to awake out of sleep, we're told. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The Apostle Paul says it's time to awake out of sleep. If you look at the story of the 10 virgins in Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 10, it says the wise and the foolish were all slumbering and sleeping. There was an event that takes place in verse 6 of Matthew chapter 25. It says, at midnight, behold, there was a cry made, and it says all the virgins, wise and foolish, started trimming their lamps, representing the word of God. The only problem was is that the foolish did not have any oil, or very little oil, not enough to take them through that difficult time. And so they're asking the wise, give us some of your oil. And the wise said to them, not so, lest there not be enough for us and you too. In other words, we cannot transform our characters into someone else. We cannot transfer them into someone else. It has to be a growing personal experience with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so it is time to awake out of sleep before it is eternally too late. Well, let's take a look and see what the Word of God says. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. And who is that light? Jesus Christ is that light. We need to put on the light of Jesus and have that robe of righteousness. What do you say? We find, again, this picture that I've showed a number of times of Uncle Sam reaching over and grasping the hand of the Roman power. Grasping the hand of the Roman power. And so, has that happened? I believe it is. What did the Great Controversy have to say about that in page 588 of the Great Controversy? The Protestants of the United States will be foremost in stretching their hands across the gulf to grasp the hand of spiritualism, and they'll reach over the abyss to clasp the hands of the Roman power. Now remember, Ellen White wrote that book in the 1800s. So if she wrote the book in the 1800s, long before any of this was foreseen to take place, someone had to reveal that this is what was going to take place here at the end of time. She saw that. She was told that. And under the influence of this threefold union, this country will follow in the steps of Rome in trampling on the rights of conscience. Trampling on the rights of conscience. Has the United States reached over? Have we grasped the hand of Rome? Washington Times, House, United States Congress and the House votes 416-1 to give the Vatican a stronger voice in the United Nations. Is that happening? Oh, yes. Reaching over and grasping the hands. If anything, Representative Christopher Smith said, the Holy See deserves a more prominent role in the United Nations. Why would we want to set up a religious system in the United Nations to dictate of how the world should judge and how they should do their daily duties and the laws that they should perform and make? Maranatha, page 131, we read, any movement in favor of religious legislation is really an act in concession of the papacy, which for so many ages has steadily warred against liberty of conscience. What are we told? Any movement in favor of religious legislation is really an act of concession to who? The Baptist? It's to Rome. The bottom line is a concession to the papacy. Have we reached out? Here we end. We have a picture of the former Secretary of State at the Vatican meeting with the Pope. We have former President Jimmy Carter. He was a Protestant, supposedly. He's at the Vatican meeting with the Pope. We have Ronald Reagan, Protestant, meeting with the Pope. We have George H.W. Bush, Protestant, meeting at the Vatican with the Pope. We have former Bill Clinton, President, Baptist, Protestant, supposedly, meeting at the Vatican with the Pope. We have our sitting President, George W. Bush, at the Vatican, meeting with the Pope. Here we have all these presidents I just showed you. They're all kneeling down. We've showed you this picture before, but it says 1,000 words. It says 10,000 words of here. They're all kneeling and bowing at the feet of the dead Pope. Pius is well aware that the Catholic Church can never hope to dominate the civilized world until America kneels beaten and penitent at her feet, according to the book Rome Stoops to Conquer, written by E. Boyd Barrett in 1935. 1935, they realized that they could not control the world again until America kneels at her feet. Pope John Paul II Cultural Center officially opened Tuesday, giving the nation's capital a tiny slice of the Vatican. Again, John Paul selected Washington, D.C. because he sees the city as the crossroads of technology and the people, we are told. What did he say concerning this building put there? The Pope says, we will come to view this as our little Vatican in the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, we're not waiting for Rome to take over America. They've basically already taken it over, and we're sleeping through. We've slept through the whole thing. It is dedicated to the spreading of the teaching. Romanism as a system is no more in harmony with the gospel of Christ now than in any former period in her history. The Protestant churches are in great darkness, we are told. Or they would discern the what? The signs of the times. The Roman Church is far-reaching in her plans and modes of operation. She is employing every device to extend her influence and increase her power in preparation for a fierce and determined conflict to regain control of the world and to reestablish persecution and undo all that Protestantism has done. This is their goal, and they're succeeding in that goal, and it's pretty much over. Catholicism is gaining ground on every side. See the increasing number of her churches and chapels in Protestant countries. Look at the popularity of her colleges and seminaries in America, so widely patronized by Protestants. Here we see the Pope pointing the way for our sitting president. This is the way, my son, walk ye in it. Great Controversy, page 444. The wide diversity of belief in Protestant churches is regarded by many as decisive proof that no effort to secure forced uniformity can ever be made. But there has been for years in the churches of the Protestant faith a strong and growing sentiment in favor of a union based on common points of doctrine. To secure such a union, the discussion on subjects upon which all were not agreed, however important they might be from the Bible standpoint, must necessarily be waived. We are told in the Great Controversy, written in the 1800s, that the churches would come together and they would agree on common points of doctrines. Those they couldn't agree on, they would just sort of push aside. Page 445 of the Great Controversy. When the leading churches of the United States, uniting upon such points of doctrines held by them in common, shall influence the state to enforce their decrees and to sustain their institutions, then Protestant America will have formed an image to the Roman hierarchy, and in the infliction of civil penalties upon dissenters will inevitably result. And this is what we see happening today.
Big enough for this group of Christian men. An overflow crowd actually wound up near the reflecting pool, but it didn't matter. All of them heard the same message, one of them very ambitious. Fox 5's John Hanrahan spent the day there. John.
Hillary and David, it was 6 hours long, it was enormous, and it was immensely, it was somber, and it was very, very popular for those who went. The crowd was enormous, completely filling the National Mall and its side streets from 3rd Street near the U.S. Capitol to huge spillover areas around the Washington Monument. Organizers of the Assembly of Christian Men opened their religious meeting with a pledge to steer the Promise Keepers gathering away from politics.
Come away feeling that there's a lot more unity in the body of Christ than a lot of people think. I mean, there's a lot of people from California, from down in Florida, from all over the place here, and it's amazing. Everybody's hugging. Everybody is just sharing an awful lot more than you would think.
Now, pastors, you are our leaders. You've been working with half a squad. You've been working with mostly women, but that's going to change. You have to be ready now. These guys are coming back.
Next year, Promise Keepers plans even more events in cities and towns around the world. It hopes to touch off a religious fervor that America has not seen in 100 years.
We are at a very important point in the reason we are here today, and that is to ask the Almighty God to unite His church. And on the count of three, I want all of us to say the name of our religious heritage, denomination, or name of church. One, two, three. Did anybody understand anything that was said? Now on the count of three, I would like for you to shout with me the name of the Savior who has redeemed your soul. One, two, three.
So we recognize that it's not enough just to say, I'm sorry. To repent means that we have to do it differently in the future. We pray that the Holy Spirit fall on this incredible gathering and on those watching on television and convict every single one of us. Father, we recognize that we do have doctrinal differences and that they have existed since the first days of the church. But Father, we will not let these differences destroy our unity as brothers and sisters in Christ. So Father, from this day forward as we leave here, let us look upon us and say, behold how they love one another.
Brothers, I have a new dream today. I dreamed that 400,000 churches in America that call Jesus Lord would join hands in recognition that we have one common adversary, and when we come together, we are formed that which is invincible, the power of one.
Now, what was the theme? Did anyone pick up what the theme was of this meeting? Here you had over 1 million men out there on the mall. As a matter of fact, one time they were all bowing down, praying, and they faced the Capitol building in Washington, D.C., where they make the laws of this nation. And you had 1 million men out there, 1 million warm bodies kneeling down, praying, bowing in the dirt there on the mall. It reminded me of what it must have been like just a little bit of the Plain of Dura, when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow. And praise God, those who are out there helping us hand out literature that day, far as I know, we're the only ones that weren't bowing. And I praise the Lord that we weren't. But what was the theme for this outdoor meeting, calling these million men together? Stand in the gap. Stand in the gap. Of course, we find that in Ezekiel, and it's dealing with God's law, specifically the Sabbath issue. Did you notice where he says, I'm calling on 400,000 churches across America to join hands, to come together? Max Lucado got up there and talked about, give us the name of your church, and it sounded like Babylon. There were so many different things coming up, but all of a sudden they're all in the unity there at the end where all the churches are coming together. Are we going to be able to join with them? Not unless you're willing to give up the Sabbath. Not unless you're willing to give up the truths of the state of the dead and the sanctuary message. Folks, we need to know where we are in time. Stand in the gap. That was the issue of the meetings. Again, in the Great Controversy, we read, Great Controversy, page 463, popular revivals are too often carried by appeals to the imagination, by exciting emotions, by gratifying the love for what is new and startling. Converts thus gained have little desire to listen to Bible truth, little interest in the testimony of the prophets and the apostles. You know, I found it quite interesting. I met with a group of young people here not too long ago. They're all into this Christian rock or contemporary music. They have no interest. I found out they have very, very little interest in studying the Bible, and a large portion of them don't believe in the spirit of prophecy. But that's what it says. Converts thus again have little desire to listen to the Bible truth, little interest in testimony of prophets and apostles. I'm telling you, as one who was raised in the church and left it for 34 years before Jesus finally got my attention. We cannot keep our young people in the church just because we have bebop music and just because we entertain them. We need to give them the truth. The truth will set them free. The truth will have them desiring to want to follow Jesus and follow that truth as it is in Christ, not these modern revivals. Unless a religious service has something of a sensational character, it has no attractions for them. The converts do not renounce their pride and love of the world. We're getting to the point in the churches where we've got to entertain. We've got to have nightclub acts almost. We've got to have all kinds of dramas. We've got to have puppets. We've got to have all kinds of gimmicks to try to lead people to keep them in the church so we can have numbers in our churches. That's what the churches, other denominations are doing. Ladies and gentlemen, let us not fall into those same traps and pitfalls. Study the Word of God so we can see these pitfalls. There are no more willing to deny self, to take up the cross and follow the meek and lowly Jesus than before their conversion, we are told. Great Controversy, page 464, written in the 1880s. It says, before the final visitation of God's judgments upon the earth, there will be among the people of the Lord such a revival of primitive godliness as has not been witnessed since apostolic times. And I don't know about you, but I'm longing for that day, and I want to be part of that movement. How about you? I want to have the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon me. How about you? And the only way we're going to do that is if we let the Holy Spirit lead us now. If we're willing to do His will now, we'll receive it then. But it says, before that time comes, the Spirit and power of God will be poured out upon His children. And before it comes, the enemy of souls desires to hinder this work. And before the time for such a movement shall come, Satan will endeavor to prevent it by introducing a what? A counterfeit. He's going to end up entering in a counterfeit into the churches. Modern revivals. Counterfeit outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Is that happening today? How many of you know this man? His name is Benny Hinn. Benny Hinn. What's happening with his congregations? And by the way, thousands upon thousands of people go. We're there in many of his crusades around there handing literature out to help people to find the truth. But these people are duped. They're duped, and there are thousands. And it's interesting to know that sometimes we even find Seventh-day Adventists at these meetings. Need to stay away from such meetings. This is some of the things that go on in his meetings.
Keep fire. Oh, ah, fuck, Bilba. Fire. 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 Whoa. That's glorious. Fire on you. Fire on you, kid. Right. Look at this on your young people. Look at this anointing on your young people.
Look at this anointing on your young people. Is that the anointing of the Holy Spirit? Seems to me, I read in the Bible where Jesus was delivering young people from these types of spirits, not putting these spirits into them. Look at this anointing on your young people. But that's exactly what is written in the Great Controversy of the things that would be taking places in the churches. What else is going on? Multitudes will exult that God is working marvelous for them when the work is that of another spirit. Under religious guise, Satan will seek to extend his influence over the Christian world. He's using these techniques to extend his influence over the Christian world. And it's coming into our church. We have to be so ever careful. What else is happening coming into our churches?
It's the new sound of Christianity. At a time when music sales are down overall, religious and gospel music is hotter than ever, attracting not only believers, but non-Christian listeners, and perhaps most importantly, profit-starved big music labels that know how to make hits. It's all God's children singing glory, glory,
hallelujah. Christian music is business is one of the fastest growing media businesses in America, if not the fastest growing. Gather at the
river of forgiveness. Point of Grace is a kind of Dixie Chicks for the devotional set.
We'll use any style of any modern contemporary style of music that appeals to a mass audience to communicate biblical truths. That could be about a social issue, a current event, and it could also point people directly to scriptures. So it could be all kinds of music.
Sometimes the sound is hip-hop. Please don't call me conservative. God creates, man just perverts it. Sometimes it's hard rock. Today, the tent is bigger than ever. Not only are televangelists reaching larger audiences electronically, they're preaching in person to mega congregations, and the ministers and their flocks are multi-million dollar economic forces in their own right. Then there's Texas Bishop T.D. Jakes. He's already produced 8 albums, 6 got Grammy nominations. He's won one.
I think what we try to do with our record label is to find music with a message, primarily that is Christian music, but sometimes it's just positive music or just music in general.
But are the commercial demands of the medium diluting the purity of the message?
These kinds of expressions are selling, but are they capturing the fullness of the faith? I think that's a big concern to many theologians.
So I see the future as whatever, wherever popular culture is moving, wherever the music is moving, we will move with it, and we'll do that in order to reach the most amount of people as possible.
We just see the movement of the Lord here and the Spirit of the Lord, and we just see this happening all over the country.
What did he say? We see the movement of the Lord here. We see the Spirit of the Lord here moving all across the country, all across the country. This is what's going on in churches all across the country, is right. But whose spirit is it? Whose spirit is driving this? You know, a lot of people say, and I run into people all the time, and they talk to me, oh, this music makes me feel so good. And I say, ladies and gentlemen, just because you put the name Jesus in a song doesn't make it of God. I remember a famous preacher one time talking about a bar room in South L.A., across the other side of the tracks. It was a dirty, dingy, dark, dank bar. It had graffiti on the walls, windows broken out, needed painting, trashed around it. Dirty. You know what the name of it was? Paradise. Paradise. Just because you call it paradise doesn't make it paradise. Just because we put the name Jesus in the music doesn't mean it's of God. You got to remember that Lucifer himself was the head of the angelic choir. He knows what music will do. He knows how it will affect your mind and how it will draw you closer to the Lord. I talked to one person one day who was very upset because I was talking about this. Got very angry. Oh, this music makes me feel so good. This makes me feel this. This makes me feel that. Ladies and gentlemen, we serve by faith, not by sight, not by feeling. I said, well, if it makes you feel so good, what does it make you want to do after you listen to this music? Do you want to go out and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with someone after? Does it make you want to take a truth-filled magazine and piece of literature and go up and knock on a door in someone's home and share truth with them? Oh, this person says, I don't care what kind of music I listen to. I really don't want to do that. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if we don't want to share the love of Jesus Christ, if we don't want to share Jesus and his soon coming, then we're not converted. Because when we're converted, you're going to share, because what you love, you will share. If you love football, you share football. If you love soap operas, you're going to share about the soap operas. If you love good food, a certain restaurant, you're going to tell people about that certain restaurant. And if you love Jesus Christ, guess what? You're going to share Jesus Christ, because we're told in the pen of inspiration that to not share Jesus Christ, if you're a Christian, would be like trying to stop the waters from falling over the Niagara Falls. But this is what's happening. What does inspiration tell us about this? Selected Messages, Volume 2, page 36. The Lord has shown me what would take place just before the what? Just before the close of probation. Every uncouth thing will be demonstrated. There will be shouting with drums and music and dancing. The senses of rational beings will become so confused that they cannot be trusted to make right decisions. And this is called the moving of the Holy Spirit. Listen, the Holy Spirit, what's that word? The Holy Spirit never, ladies and gentlemen, never reveals itself in such methods, in such bedlam of noise. When is this supposed to be taking place in our churches, and including Adventist churches? Just before the close of human probation. It's a wake-up call. It's a wake-up call. This is an invention of Satan to cover up his ingenious methods for making of none effect the pure, sincere, elevating, ennobling, sanctifying truth for this time. It's an invention of Satan to try to distract us, to keep our attention away from what we really need to be doing. Great controversy also continues. There's another issue, page 558. There are few who have any just conception of the deceptive power of spiritualism and the danger coming under its influence. The traffic stopped in a Chicago underpass after a stain, which many say looks like the Virgin Mary, appeared on the wall. How many of you heard about this? There's this stain, and people say it looks like the Virgin Mary in Chicago, and it stops traffic, and people by the thousands go. Well, if you haven't heard it, let me share with you a little about it.
There's been a lot of talk lately about the importance of faith in this country, and so it's against that backdrop that a vision has appeared in Chicago. It's on the wall of a highway overpass, and it is drawing crowds of believers. NBC's Kevin Tibbles is with us tonight from the scene in Chicago. Kevin, good evening.
Good evening, Brian. Down here, it is dark, dank, and as you can hear, almost deafening. Just above me, the evening rush hour. But what's on this wall, people are saying, transcends it all.
In the crush and chaos of Chicago traffic, a most unlikely place for pilgrims seeking serenity. But many are finding it down here, in what they believe is a gift sent from above, a vision of the Virgin Mary.
These things are miracles, and you have to honor and respect that.
Thousands have come, creating a grotto of flowers and candles, praying, weeping. It's certainly not the first time the faithful have found Mary off the beaten track. There was the beach in Australia, the hospital window in Boston, even thought some on a grilled cheese sandwich. Northwestern University religion professor Christina Traina says people often find these symbols in times of uncertainty.
I think they do happen more frequently around profound times of social upheaval or social change. And for people who are switching cultures through immigration.
Many Mexican Americans now living here say it resembles Our Lady of Guadalupe, Mexico's patron saint. And in the wake of Pope John Paul II's death, some in the Polish community believe the image celebrates his life.
He was a pope who was extraordinarily devoted to the Virgin Mary.
Many of the curious and faithful trekking here say at first they're skeptical. That is, of course, until they take a picture, often using their cell phone. That's when they say the image becomes very clear.
You could see some facial outlines and that it did look different.
Excuse me.
Police have had to set up barricades, all for what the Department of Transportation calls a salt and water stain from winter runoff. A down-to-earth explanation for something believers are calling divine.
For its part, the Archdiocese of Chicago says the image may help some people reaffirm their faith. It is neither encouraging nor discouraging people from coming here. As for highway officials, they say they've got no plans to scrub the wall.
Now, some of you laughed when you heard about the grilled cheese sandwich. on eBay, that grilled cheese sandwich sold for $28,000. People take it very seriously. You say, well, we couldn't be fooled like that. We wouldn't be involved in anything like that. And so we have a tendency to laugh at those kind of things. But there are millions of people who are involved in this type, in this form of spiritualism. But not only does it affect them, but there are also things that are affecting some of God's people. Time magazine front cover, Why Harry Potter Rules. Why Harry Potter Rules. I am amazed how many Adventist families allow their children to read Harry Potter books. I am amazed how many of them have Harry Potter movies. Again, I was talking to a large group of young people in our church, in one of our schools, and I asked, how many read Harry Potter books? Quite a number of hands went up. Somebody even in the background hollered out, and we go to Harry Potter movies too. The Lord is trying to warn us to get our attention away from these things, and we're going right into the devil's trap. Ladies and gentlemen, all you have to do is look in the Bible of what the Word of God has to say about wizards, which Harry Potter is supposed to be a wizard. It's an abomination unto the Lord. Why would we want to read things that's an abomination to the Lord? Why would we want to put that garbage in our minds? Why would we want that in our hearts? Oh, we think it's so innocent. Just like Eve, she thought it was innocent. That piece of fruit on a tree looked appealing, smelled good, looked good. It was appetizing. And look at the heartache it's brought. And so we're told that it's going to affect. I was doing some meetings in a camp meeting a year or so ago, and I was talking about some of the programs on television. I was in one church one day, and the choir was singing, Academy Choir was singing, and I said, can you name me one program on ABC, CBS, NBC that would lead you closer to the Lord? Can you name me one? One young girl, about 16-year-old, in the choir raised her hand, and I acknowledged her, and she said, touched by an angel. What does touched by an angel teach you? Spiritualism, ladies and gentlemen. And this man, a grown man in his 70s, got angry with me when I shared about we shouldn't be watching programs like that. Now you have medium. You have all kinds of programs that have come in. Pope's Peace Retreat brings faith together at St. Francis' birthplace. I was doing some meetings in Northern California. We were in Sacramento. We were getting ready to leave to go over to the airport to fly back home. I noticed the headline on the newspaper, Pope's Peace Retreat brings faith together at St. Francis' birthplace. The article goes on to say, the event represented one of the largest gatherings ever of Christian groups, bringing together Catholics, Baptists, Lutherans, Quakers, Mennonites, and Orthodox Christians, among others. They joined representatives of 11 other religions, Jews, Muslims, Hindus, Buddhists, Shintoists, Sikhs, Jainists, and followers of Tenrikyo, tribal religions, Confucianism, and Zoroastrianism. Are you getting the picture? Confucianism, where do you find it? China. How many people in China? Over 1 billion. Hinduism, where do you find it? India. How many people in India? Over 1 billion. How many Muslims are there in the world? Over 1 billion. How many Catholics are there in the world? Over 1 billion. Are you getting the picture? The whole world is represented here. Our church was invited to go to these meetings, but praise God, we did not go. Amen? We didn't go. So here you have the Buddhists and the Muslims and the Hindus and all kinds of tribal religions, Zoroastrianism. And as I studied through all of these different religions, I found that there was a thread, a golden thread, basically, that went through all of them. They're all involved in spiritualism. And who invited them together? The Pope. Who engineered the meeting? The Pope. And that got my attention, but this is what really got my attention. The retreat included an inaugural testimony for peace, ceremony that was punctuated by Buddhist chants and Christian hymns, prayer sessions, lunch, and a final communal pledge. John Paul arrived in Assisi on what the Italian media dubbed the train of prayers, bringing the religious leaders with him. Italy's State Railroad gave the Vatican a 7-car train, each car bearing the Vatican's coat of arms. Get the picture, ladies and gentlemen. The Pope engineers the whole thing. He's got a choo-choo train with 7 cars with the Vatican's coat of arms on it. And the leaders of the world, representing the entire world, all kinds of religions representing the world, are all in this train. As soon as I read that, what little bit of hair I got on the back of my neck started to rise up because I thought of this quote in the book Early Writings, page 263. I saw the rapidity with which this delusion was spreading. It's talking about spiritualism. A train of cars was shown me, going with the speed of lightning. The angel bade me look carefully. I fixed my eyes upon the train. It seemed that the whole world was on board. Did she see 6.5 billion people on a train? No, but I believe she saw the representation of the world on the train, and they're all on board. Then he showed me the conductor, a very fair, stately person whom all the passengers looked up to and reverenced. So I asked my attending angel who it was. He said, it is Satan. He is the conductor in the form of an angel of light. He has taken the world captive. They are going over to strong delusion to believe a lie that they may be damned. His agent, speaking of the agent that Satan was using, the next highest in order to him is the engineer. And the others of his agents are employed in different offices as he may need them. And they are all going with the lightning speed to perdition. She's talking about spiritualism. God had revealed this to her. And it was taken in the context that this would be happening just before the close of human probation. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, we need to awake out of our sleep. Matthew 24:24, we read these things. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the, who? The very elect. The very elect. Who are the very elect? Oh, yes, because you have your name on a church book, you think you're elect? That's not it. Because you go to church on Saturday, you're elect? No, that's not it. The elect, we're told by the pen of inspiration, the elect are those who believe that God can and will save them from sin, not in sin, but from sin. Here we have a picture. It was a picture that was on the front cover of a ministerial magazine. A magazine for the clergy. It is supposed to be depicting the second coming of Jesus Christ based upon the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. I challenge anyone to come up with this picture based upon scripture, based upon inspiration. I was doing some meetings in West Virginia. I was sharing some of these, and I shared this picture along with some other pictures there. A lady who was there used to be a witch. God saved her from being a witch. She became a member of our church. And she shared 32 spiritualistic symbols in this picture. And yet it was given to clergy around this country and other parts of the world. Other parts of the world. I don't know who this is. I know for certain it's not Jesus Christ. But it could be his imposter, that's for sure. It's got people clinging on, those who are going to be lost. And they've got like demons hanging on to them. You have people that are like spirits. You can see the feet of this person through this person here who's part flesh and part spirit. Symbols. Spiritualism. Upward Look, page 317, the pen of inspiration writes, I warn our people that right among us, some will turn away from the faith and give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And by them, the truth will be evil spoken of. I warn our people that among us, some are going to fall away into spiritualism. And I'm sharing with you that if we're involved with Harry Potter, if we're watching Medium, if we're involved in all these different movies and television shows that are promoting all this garbage, when the test comes, unless you're part of the elect, you're going to be swept away. There's another issue. Spiritual gifts, volume 3, something that would be taking place in the world just before the close of probation and Jesus comes. Spiritual Gifts, Volume 3, page 64, I read this. If there was one sin above another which called for the destruction of the race by the flood, it was the base crime of amalgamation of man and beast, which defaced the image of God and caused confusion everywhere. Inspiration said, if there's one sin that brought on the flood and the destruction of the world, it was the base crime of amalgamation, of combining human beings and animals, which deface the image of God. Now, a lot of people say, oh, that's not amalgamation. Amalgamation is these other animals and plants. And no. This one defaces the image of God, ladies and gentlemen. And the only creature created in his image was man. It says that this was going on in the days of the flood. Have you ever wondered why these folks who are involved in evolution and they find some bones in West Africa someplace and they date them back to being so many thousands upon thousands and tens of thousands of years old that looks like it's partly human and partly monkey? You ever wonder about that? Could it have been going on back in their day? You got to remember, they lived to be 800 years old. They were much more intelligent than we are today. We're only using maybe less than 10% of our brains. They used a whole lot more back in that day. We've fallen 4,000 years since then in sin. Amalgamation, what is it? It is the mixture, the blending, or the combination of two species. Washington Post, November 04, stem cell research. What's happening in our world? In Minnesota, pigs are being born with human blood in their veins. In Nevada, there are sheep whose livers and hearts are largely human. In California, mice peer from their cages with human brain cells firing in their skulls. This is what's happening in the laboratories across America. But that's only a little bit of what is taking place, ladies and gentlemen. These are not outcasts from the island of Dr. Moreau, the 1869 novel of H.G. Wells, in which the rogue doctor develops creatures that are part animal and part human. They are real creations of real scientists stretching the boundaries of stem cell research. Biologists call these hybrid animals chimeras, after the mythical Greek creature with a lion's head, a goat's body, a serpent's tail. They are the products of experiments in which human stem cells are added to developing animal fetuses. National Post Online wrote, man-beast hybrid beyond talking stage. Melding man and beast may sound like stuff from science fiction, but it is not. Amid all the advances in genetic manipulation, the idea of combining the DNA of animals and humans has gone beyond the talking stage. It's been attempted. Indeed, many scientists and academics are wondering how far it might go and what the ethical implications would be. If a human were crossed with a chimpanzee, for example, would it still be human? And if not, then what would it be? As far as we know, it would still be like a human being, but some of the characteristics of individual cells might be slightly different, said James Cross, a molecular biologist at the University of Calgary. This suggests that we can create a new human-animal species, said Jerry Rifkin. Rifkin called the experiment the most extraordinary single development in the history of biotechnology. Ladies and gentlemen, can you understand what's going on? We're told that this would be taking place just before the close of probation. Last October, Greenpeace Germany dug up a patent claim for a similar human-animal hybrid. Only this time, it involved a pig. U.S.-based biotransplant and Austro-based stem cell sciences grew a pig-human embryo to 32 cells before ending its life. If the embryo had lived, it would have been 95% human, said Michael Koo. The possibilities are not only frightening, but it's unknown just how many other similar patent applications are out there. This is what we know happening in our country. What is happening where they're not regulated in other parts of the world? Chimpanzees share about between 95% and 98% of our genes, so the prospect of creating a human-chimpanzee hybrid are highly probable, Rifkin said. Right now, technology is way ahead of ethics. Oh, I see faces. Faces that are grinching, squinching. This is what's going on, ladies and gentlemen. This is what's happening. We were told that these things would happen just before human probation closes. MSNBC, April 29, 05. Biological mixing of species, but the biological commingling of animal and human is now evolving into more exotic and unsettling mixes of species, invoking the Greek myth of the monstrous chimera. What is a chimera again? A monster in Greek mythology that has the head of a lion, the body of a goat, the tail of a dragon, an organism or a recombinant DNA molecule created by joining DNA fragments from two or more different organisms, according to the Bitech Dictionary. Some time ago on PBS, they had a program called Bloodlines. Bloodlines. It says, are we creating a world that we won't want to inhabit? And this is what they presented, or a portion that was presented on this program.
A human, non-human animal that's a mixture.
We've applied for a patent on part human, part chimpanzee.
How are new life technologies challenging what it means to be human?
Well, you might be surprised that mammals of different species, such as sheep and goats, for example, can be combined at the early embryo stages, and their cells cooperate and give rise to a composite organism. It's called a chimera.
Really?
You simply take cells from different species, you jumble them together, you grow them for a while in a petri dish, and then you can implant them into a surrogate mother of either species.
And this can be done now? I mean, it seems as though it's some futuristic idea that...
No, it's perfectly feasible to do it now.
Has anyone tried this yet?
Well, it's been tried with goats and sheep, and this was back in the 1980s, and they were called geeps. Humans and chimpanzees are closer to each other genetically than sheep and goats are. So if this type of thing is possible with sheep and goats, it's almost certainly possible with chimpanzees and humans. Yes, in fact, we've applied for a patent on an embryo that's part human and part chimpanzee.
Part chimpanzee? Why are you gonna do this? I mean, are you?
Well, there's a scientific motivation, there's a medical motivation. These animals would be perfect donors for transplanted hearts, kidneys, half the cells in their body would be human cells.
There's a number of applications that raise issues similar to yours, and we've collected here a series of patents that have been issued since we filed your case that raise some of those issues, things like transgenic animals, cloning techniques, ES cell-based techniques. There's one here, transgenic swine and swine cells.
That's very interesting, because here they are actually causing these organisms to exhibit human characteristics by putting in human genes, so these tissues would not be rejected by a human recipient. So if they're already issuing patents on pigs with human genes, how many human genes would it take for them to start saying, well, you're doing something that embraces a human? I mean, they have...
We don't have a very good legal grounding to answer the question, what is human? And yet, so much of our lives depend on that criteria. Issues like how we treat one another, what our rights and responsibilities are. If I encounter an entity that has half chimp genes and half human genes, how do I relate to it? The law will govern such things as whether that animal, entity, human can be killed at will, whether it has a right to attend public schools, whether it has freedom of speech.
If the Supreme Court and the Patent Office have gone so far as to accept patents on non-human animals and patents on human cells and patents on human embryo stem cells, why shouldn't they allow a patent on something that's half human? This is perfectly feasible and perfectly legal and perfectly useful at the present time.
It says it's perfectly legal and it's personally feasible, but it didn't say anything about ethical. It didn't say anything about moral, did he? Why would they want to do such thing? Well, if you need an extra heart, you need another heart, you need some lungs, you need some livers, you need some kidneys, then you can create these types of beings, whatever they might end up being, and that your body will not reject them. And as that lawyer said on there, would you be able to kill them at will? Would they have human rights? Would they have animal rights? Can you believe just having these conversations, just discussing this, turned your stomach? But we are told that this would take place. Again, Spiritual Gifts, Volume 3, page 64. If there was one sin above another which called for the destruction of the race by the flood, it was the base crime of amalgamation of man and beast, which defaced the image of God and caused confusion everywhere. It's going to cause confusion. And it's taking place just before the destruction of the Antediluvian world. Ladies and gentlemen, we're on the borders of eternity. Jesus is coming. The signs are here. He's letting us know over and over again, these books are not written. They're not fiction. The Great Controversy is not a fictitious book. It's a book to help us to understand where we are in time. The warnings in the Bible, the warnings in the spirit of prophecy. We need to stand up and take heed to these things before it is too late. Before it is too late. And Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 37, as it was in the days of Noah, so also shall the coming of the Son of Man be. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming again. He also said in Matthew 24, verse 32 and 33, now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. What doors is Jesus talking about? Some people say, oh, he's talking about the door to your heart. No, ladies and gentlemen, he's been knocking on the doors of hearts since Adam and Eve. He's talking about the doors of the sanctuary. James chapter 5, verse 9. You can look it up. Once he walks through that door of the sanctuary, once he leaves the most holy of the sanctuary, walks through that door, probation is closed. Human probation is over. You will be eternally decided for heaven or eternal loss. And it's my prayer here today that all of us, and those who might watch these tapes, those who might watch these DVDs, make your decision today for Jesus. You know whether you're playing Christian or not. You know whether you're playing church or not. You know the Lord knows your hearts. For to be 85% saved is to be 100% lost. Choose ye this day whom you will serve. With those who agree with me that Jesus is coming soon, that probation is about to close, and you say in your heart of hearts, I want to be ready for Jesus. If that is your desire, would you stand with me as we have our closing prayer? Let us pray. Our kind Father in heaven, we can certainly see all around us the signs of the time screaming out at us. Jesus is coming. Probation's about to close. Oh, Lord, I pray that not one person within the sound of my voice, not one person that will ever watch these tapes will be lost, but they will make their decision to follow you. You've seen the decisions that people have made here today, and Lord, I pray that you would send a double guard of angels to protect them, to keep them from harm and danger. May they not be distracted by any means. May they keep their eyes focused and fixed on Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith, and that none of us here would be lost, that we would be saved in thy kingdom at last. Oh, Lord, help us as a people not only be prepared ourselves, but to help others to be prepared, that they too might one day soon look up in the eastern sky and say, lo, this is our God, and he will save us. And we'll hear those precious, precious words, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter ye into the joy of the Lord. This we pray for and thank you for and look for with great anticipation in the precious and holy and wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.